Hi there, friends. It's lilydunbar.com. Lily here. Thank you for joining me on Monday here for our Facebook Live Bible study. We're going to be looking at just a few more verses from 1 Peter chapter 3. And this week, we're actually going to be looking at some verses that deal with marriage. So we're going to look at the first six verses of 1 Peter chapter 3. But if you're not married, please stick around, because I think that the wisdom that is shared here is applicable to any relationship. And I don't know if you know my story, but I did not get married until I was almost 42 years old. I met my husband when I was in my 40s. And so I was professionally single for a long time. And so I remember when I would come across these passages, thinking about how I didn't have to pay attention. But I realized I do, because the principles from this passage really is applicable to all of our relationships, because it's how we treat one another and how we love one another and how we work well together. So I hope you'll stick around even if you're not a married gal. So, I hope you had a great weekend. It's such a pleasure to be here with you. It's very funny and ironic, or actually probably divinely appointed, that I would be looking at these verses from 1 Peter chapter 3 this week, because Wednesday is my wedding anniversary. So I will have been married 9 years to Mr. Bruce Dunbar, the man that of my dreams. He's been so good to me, and I married up. Girls, can I tell you, he is such a good guy. He takes such good care of me. He's so selfless and giving, and he makes me laugh, and he puts up with all my quirky stuff. And I'm very blessed to have him in my life. I'm so thankful for every day that I waited for him, because he was totally worth the wait. So yes, 9 years of marriage. So this was a good study for me this week, a reminder of what my role is as a wife and how to have a healthy and strong marriage. So I hope that this will be a blessing to you. So let's get started. How's that sound? If you're here, go ahead and wave hello in the comments. I can't see your comments for some reason on my phone, but you can go ahead and just tell me where you're from, and I'll see after the video. I'll check in and I'll chat with you guys down there. And tag a friend underneath the video if you think this will be an encouragement to them, and share on your page. And let's help get some encouragement out there on Monday, out in the face of Facebook of fear and in the internet of fear. Oh, I see one friend. Hi there. So we're going to look at the first six verses of 1 Peter chapter 3. I'm reading from the ESV translation. So let's get started. Verse 1 says, "Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct." Verse 3 says, "Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is in God's sight is very, very precious." Verse 5, "For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their husbands. As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening." All right. This is a hard passage for some people. So let's just admit it now. Some of us really struggle with this passage, and that's okay, because that's part of being a human. I mean, of just, you know, wrestling out our faith. And so let's wrestle it out together, shall we? So verse 1 says that we should be subject to our own husbands, or in some verses it might use the word submit. Now, I know that some people view this as antiquated, but let's just be honest in that when you are, you know, for example, driving a car, only one person can be behind the wheel. And so what it's saying here is that one person has to lead the car. You know what I'm saying? One person has to drive, and the other person is there to hold the map and to direct and to pray for, you know, safety on the road, and to just be in the vehicle as a supporting person. And so, you know, here what it's saying is that we need to honor the fact that God has created order in all our relationships. And so just as the previous weeks we talked about, first we talked about when we deal with politicians earlier in chapter 3, government, and how we need to honor the position if we don't like the practice. And then we talked about our employees and how we need to persevere through those difficult relationships and continue to do good. So this entire chapter has really been about how to live a submissive life. And now he's hitting it home. I mean, he is not packing any punches here in chapter 3 as we start. He is turning to where it hurts the most. He's going to the home, and he's talking about the people that we deal with the most, you know, our spouse. And so, you know, family can be hard. You know, it's so easy to like be nice to other people sometimes, but when you're home, you're just like, bring it. Come on. Let's go down. You know what I'm talking about? You want to like have it the way you want to have it sometimes. And so here in this passage, Peter is encouraging us that the way to win the war is by saying nothing. to let the person lead, even if we don't agree. And so specifically here, if you look at the passage, he's actually specifically speaking to a wife who is married to someone who does not follow God. So if you notice that, he says, likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. So he's giving good advice for when there's conflict in marriage, when you don't feel like you're heading in the same direction. In this case, particularly, if, for example, if you're a person of faith and maybe your husband is not a person of faith, and or maybe I have a friend who she married, her husband was a person of faith, and during the course of their marriage, he's become an agnostic. He started to struggle with doubt, and now he no longer believes that there is a God, and he's wrestling in that way. And so her marriage has really changed from the beginning of her marriage. And she is living out this passage so beautifully. She's such an example to me of how she honors her husband and she lets him, you know, be the person that he is and lets him lead respectfully. And so she doesn't try to change him. She understands that only God can change him. And so her job is to just love him where he's at and to pray through. So I wrote down some things for this particular first verse, and that is that the word submit here is actually a military term. If you read it in the actual Greek, it means to order under. Those are the exact meaning of the word. So it's like you're a soldier in a war. You know, if you're a soldier in a war, there is a general, and everybody with their gun can't be heading wherever they want. There are certain plans. I've got an itchy eye. Sorry about that. Everybody can't be heading in their own direction. Everybody has to follow a specific battle plan. And so here, Peter's saying, you know, we have to let in this case, we have to follow our husband's lead and let him lead. And if he's not leading in a way that we want to go, then we can, you know, we can pray through that. But God will hold him responsible, and we need to trust that God is still God and that God is in control and that God can work and can change things and can turn things around as we continue to just love our husband where he's at and help him work through those things. So verse 2 says, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. So, you know, the idea of the end of verse 1, it says that they will be won without a word. So the idea that your influence in your marriage comes from your behavior. It comes from your attitude. It comes from your lifestyle that's attractive. You witness without words. You witness through your way that you love and the way that you support and the way that you encourage rather than nag, which is really hard sometimes as a wife. So submission shows that we trust God. That we trust God to do a work in our marriages. And so I don't have to wrestle with my husband. I can wrestle out in prayer, and that can then God can change my husband. So one of the greatest pieces of marital advice I ever got when I first got married was from my friend Chrissy. And she said that when she and her husband don't agree on something, And her husband's a Christian, but she said when she and her husband don't agree on something, she'll talk about it one time, she'll explain what her opinion is, and then she will just say, "Okay, well, if that's what you want to do, then, I respectfully disagree, but I'm going to honor your choice and we'll do it that way, and, that's fine." And then she lets go of it. And then if it's something that's ongoing, she can continue to pray about it, that God would either change her heart or change her husband's heart. And she said something to me that has proved true in my own marriage, which is she's been surprised at how much, like, way down the road, God will change her husband's heart on certain issues, or God will change her heart on certain issues and will show her how her husband was really right. And so the work that she does is in praying. And I have found the same to be true in my marriage. Literally years down the road, a couple of years down the road, after praying about something that I let Bruce, we went with the way that Bruce wanted to do something, and I wasn't totally, I kind of felt icky about it, but we went ahead and did it the way he wanted to do it. And a couple years later down the road, Bruce said, "You know what? I think we're going to try to do it this way." And it was the way that I had suggested initially. And but God, I didn't nag. God did a work in my husband's heart. I just loved him where he was at. And there has been many, many, many times, more times than in the first situation, where I've seen down the road where my husband really was right. Because God, I think, gives my husband a special wisdom. And even in, I have a family of history where one of my parents is a believer and the other one is not, is not a Christ follower. And I find it to be true in my own family as well. Even when the person is not necessarily a Christ follower, sometimes because of the position they're in as a parent or a spouse, they will make a decision that's wise, even though they're not coming from a position of wisdom. And I remember as a teenager thinking, "Oh, well, they don't know God, so I don't have to do that." But seeing down the road how God really honored me for honoring that parent, and that parent really was making wise choices, even though they're not, their found biblical foundation is not there. And so, it's just, again, it's the position that God places us in and the order that we have. And so it's a beautiful thing when we can trust God, that God is going to be God no matter what, that we're honoring God as we love our spouse and as we let our spouse lead, and as we encourage our spouse and we support our spouse in our marriage, rather than, forcing things our way and arguing and following and striving and all that uncomfortableness. So verse 4 says, or verse 3 says, "Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold and jewelry, but let your adorning be of the hidden person of the heart, with imperishable beauty of gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious." So here we're talking about the difference between external temporary beauty and internal permanent beauty. He says that the beauty that comes from within, from a gentle and quiet spirit, from meekness, from trusting God, from humility, from honoring our spouse. I like to say there's the three H's here. There's humility, there's honoring, and there's hope. Putting hope that God is in control, those three things, those create a beauty in us that comes from within and comes out of our lives. It has nothing to do with what we're wearing or what makeup we're using or how great our hair looked that morning. It has to do with our attitude, and our heart attitude is what's really, 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 really beautiful. And so, the serenity, the trust, and the peace that we have in Christ, our right behavior, our purity, and our fear for God, and our reverence for God, all these things are beautiful. When we show moderation, and we are wise and discerning, and we are slow to respond, rather than snapping, which sometimes can be hard because I'm a passionate Hispanic, I understand. When we do all of that, God honors that. And there's true beauty that's always present when we do that. So it's not what you wear, it's who you are. And that's really the message of this passage. And as we wrestle out those difficult parts in relationships, and we let God lead in our marriage, and we honor the positions that He's placed us in, He will honor our behavior and our choices. And as we wait and as we pray. So, verse 5 says, "For this is how holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening." So, what he's saying here is, this is not like, hey, I'm making you do this. He's saying, since the beginning of time, this is the way things have been. There's been an order to to relationships that God has created. And so he goes all the way back to the Old Testament and he says, ever since then, we've been doing this. It's not like, here in church times, Peter is all of a sudden coming down on women and saying, you're lesser than. We're not lesser than. We're partnering with. And when we partner with, we accept, what our role is, and that we can have greater influence by accepting our role rather than demanding our way. And so, men, who have led since the beginning of time, God has always held them accountable for their actions. And God is going to hold us accountable just as He's going to hold our spouse accountable. I am not God. And so it's not my job to hold my husband accountable for his choices and his behavior. My job is to pray for my husband, to support my husband, and my choices to trust my husband and to trust God shows and demonstrates an incredible amount of faith in God that I am obeying and honoring my God because He's placed me in this marriage. And, I'm doing good. And I'm leaving the results to God. And because I'm doing that, I don't have anything to fear because I have a God who provides everything that I need. He has promised to take care of me. Last week we looked at how He's promised to shepherd us. He wants to be our shepherd. It talked about that at the end of chapter 2. And the shepherd, he protects and he provides for the sheep. And he makes sure that they're not harmed. And so I can trust that, my God is going to take care of my marriage, and I don't have to demand my way or force. I can prayerfully walk in my role and stay in my lane. And if I don't agree with something, at the end of the day, if I can let my husband have that final say, and I can pray, I can continue to pray and ask God to either change my husband or change me. And it is really hard, I know, to do this, especially when it's something that we feel really strongly and passionately about. I think about you mamas and your child raising, and the way that you parent, and where you're going to live. There's so many choices in life, and sometimes we don't agree with everything with our husband. So, my encouragement to you would be to just really read through these scriptures and to pray about these scriptures. But the main thing here is that I feel like it says our beauty comes from within as we honor and as we respond with humility and as we put our hope in God and we trust that God is going to do what God said He's going to do. He's going to build our family. He's going to move us in the right direction as we look to Him and as we follow the order that He's placed and He's created for us so that we can have peace in our homes. And so, it's a constant daily battle, right? Every day I have to remind myself of this truth, and that is, I don't have to fix my husband. My job is not to fix my husband. My job is to pray for my husband. My job is to love my husband. My job is to support my husband. And so, that's how we continue to persevere in marriage, is we wrestle through those uncomfortable things when we don't agree by praying and by supporting and by loving and by trusting that God's going to work it out And there's an uncomfortable and not knowing sometimes, but God always is faithful and He always sees us through those situations. So I don't know where you're at today as you're watching this video. I don't know if you're married or if you're not married or if you had a marriage that ended. We're all in different places and everyone's story is different. So I don't want to diminish your story. I just want to encourage you to just really unpack these verses for yourself this week. Take your Bible out and read these verses and ask God what He has for you and how you're going to live out these verses this week. But for me, what I took from it was that without a word, my faith speaks by the way that I choose to support my husband and the way that I choose to trust that God is who He says He is in my marriage. So I'm encouraged by these verses as I get to the end of my 9th year of marriage, and I'm so thankful for the gift of marriage. Marriage is a lot of work. It's so much work. And there is an enemy, and he does not like the fact that we have families that are yielded to God. And so I need to be mindful of how the enemy comes in and tries to divide and bring division in my marriage. And this passage, although it's hard for some people to really trust it, it's a key to how we can have that peace and we can kind of diffuse the ticking time bomb that the enemy wants to plant in our living rooms to destroy our homes. And so I can trust that God is going to fight for my marriage as I yield myself to the order that He has placed in my life, and trust that there's a reason why only one person can drive the car. And so if I don't like which highway he chose, then I can trust that we're going to get to the destination and that God is going to get us there. So that's this week's lesson. Next week and the week that follows, we're going to take a little bit of a mini break here from Bible study for the next couple of weeks. I'm going to be doing some marriage vacationing, and I want to be able to be fully present with my family. And so I'm going to just be back like in 3 Mondays from now. So I hope that this will be encouraging to you. When we come back later, we're going to be looking at the verses towards husbands. So don't think he just talks to wives here. If you keep reading, he talks to husbands. So maybe you want to go ahead and read. I just want to share with you here the Fuel Your Faith handout that I have for you to use for Bible study that is in the Faith Fuel Library, available to subscribers on the blog. If you're not subscribed, I just want to encourage you to jump on over there to lilydunbar.com. You can sign up. I'll put a link in the email here. You can just enter your email and you'll get immediate access to the Faith Fuel Library. There's lots of wonderful resources in there. Besides this Fuel Your Faith Bible study worksheet, there's a 31-day prayer calendar. There are scriptural prayer guides to pray for your family members, for your home, and I just hope it'll be an encouragement to you. I try to add a new resource every month. All right, so that's it for today. Wisdom for wives in 1 Peter chapter 3. I hope it encouraged you where you're at. And if you're not married, I also want to just say these submissive principles are true in every single relationship. And I believe it's Ephesians chapter 5, 1, where it says, submit to one another. And there he's talking to all believers. So submission is a biblical quality that God has called us to, that we're supposed to put the other person before ourselves, and we're not supposed to demand our way. We're supposed to serve and to love and to honor. And that's not just true in marriage, but today we specifically looked at marriage. So I hope you'll be encouraged, and thanks for joining me here. God bless.